Hi, I'm Rob Cosman. Welcome to my shop. I want to introduce you to a project that we just recently completed in the hand tool workshop. This is an online workshop where I walk through the process of designing and building various projects. In the hand tool workshop, we use only hand tools. So what I'm about to show you, made entirely with hand tools, no power. The members actually told me what they wanted. They wanted a tool cabinet. They wanted a portable tool cabinet. And this is actually a great idea because I travel and teach a lot. So I'd like to have all of my tools with me in one place. And the average guy that's doing this as a hobby is sharing the garage with his wife's car. So he has to be able to pack everything up when he's done and move it into the little corner that he owns. So here it is. I'll start with the outside and work my way through. Outside case is made out of 3/4 Baltic birch. And if you're not familiar with that, all of the plies are the same, made out of the same birch, and they're the same size. They don't get smaller or bigger. There are no voids, so it's probably the best plywood to deal with. And this is the first time I ever hand cut dovetails in plywood, but it actually turned out remarkably well. My line of thinking was that with me traveling and this being shipped around, that the outside case was going to get destroyed. So the good stuff is stored and protected inside. And I figured that over time, I probably would end up having to replace the exterior case so everything inside was screwed in place so it could come apart easily. Got a little bit worried that the dovetails weren't going to be enough, even though I did space them such to keep approximately the same amount of material in both tails and pins, not something I normally do. But I thought with all the racking that would occur when it was being transported, it might be in trouble. So I went in and I drilled and put dowels in about 2 inches long in opposing angles, so down through the pin, down through the tail, all the way on all four corners. And I think it made for a much stronger joint. Now, I hate to predict, but the very first time this was shipped out, somebody managed to hit it with a forklift, fortunately not terribly hard, but enough to do that damage. So as I thought, it came true. And I store this, well, I made this fit in the inside of the pallet so that it wouldn't be hanging out anywhere, but it didn't matter, they still had it. The back, again, this is all screwed together construction so that it could easily come apart. That's why a lot of screws are used. But it's a 1/4 inch Baltic birch back sitting in a rabbet all the way around and screwed in place. Now, putting that in a rabbet that's all the way around makes it really, really helps prevent any racking. You'll notice that the feet on the bottom, these actually detach. If you were to ship anything with casters, it's just asking for trouble. They're going to get broken. So when you lift this up, those bottom pieces of white oak with the casters attached just fall out. There's two pins that go up in about an inch, so they're secure when it's in place like this, but it doesn't take anything to remove them. I'm not going to remove them right now because I need to be able to move this around. So, spin this in place and show you how it unfolds. The and the doors are different sizes for a reason. This door locks with a single little gate lock down here. Now, on this side, I remove this door. I used quick release hardware, and the nice one, I found these ones that the to release them, you actually push that in, as opposed to the older style, you'd have to reach your finger in there and pull it up. Well, I knew in cramped quarters that was going to be difficult, so nice that I found these. Now, since we're processing everything by hand, you have to have a saw bench. So, first thing we'll assemble, and by the way, in this same slot, those feet fit in here, so that when it's transported, everything is inside. So all of these are made out of maple. These end pieces are made out of Baltic birch. Everything goes together with wedges, which makes for a very quick and strong construction. Them securely. The door has four holes drilled in to correspond with these four small dowels. and this becomes my my saw bed. It's good and sturdy, just the right height for me. On this side, I have to take the bench hook out first. I teach a lot, so I need to have a means of a chalkboard, or in this case, a whiteboard. So this is made out of that same 3/4 Baltic birch plywood, but you can buy this paint that turns it into a whiteboard. So works fantastic. Easy to erase. Set that off the side for a minute. Now, I'll start on the bottom before I'll show you. Actually, let's go ahead and put this all together first. I haven't used it a lot, so I still have to get used to how everything fits in. So the center section comes up. This is heavy. It's full of iron tools. And you'll notice that the feet go out beyond the back. And I did that on purpose just to give this a little more stability, because I wanted to be able to put the cabinet all the way to the tool cabinet all the way to the back, which gives me a little bit of shelf space right here. And the wings tuck in here. And I have a system of dowels on an angle, slope slightly, so that gravity keeps everything tight. And I have feet on the bottom of these cabinets, you'll see. But I purposely made the ones on the wings just a little bit short, or a little bit narrower, so that all of the weight is on the dowels, which keeps this joint nice and tight. So as I mentioned, over here, this is my bench hook. A bench hook, in case you're not familiar with it, has a cleat in the front, so that will catch the front edge of your bench. And then you would use your crosscut saw, and this is a rough cut off out here. And the idea behind a bench hook is, once you've made your cut through, instead of dropping into your bench, you're dropping into the sacrificial bench hook. This is for a nice square cut off, kind of like a miter box. And then I've got 45s here. Figured I had them, I would use them. And then tucked in here, we have our shooting board. This is made out of 1-inch MDF. It's heavier than the lead. But it stays nice and flat. And if you're not familiar with the shooting board, I have a video that talks all about it. But that cleat catches on the front of your bench. This is square, so your plane sits on the side like this. Your work sits up against here, and as you plane, keeping the plane tight to the fence, you end up with a perfectly square end. Really increases your accuracy and speeds up the process. Put that back in. And when I'm not using it, actually, I'm going to leave that out for a minute because I want to tell you about that. I've yet to finish one more drawer. I'm a little behind. All of this, as I mentioned, was done with hand tools, with the exception of the drawer knobs. I did them on the lathe, but it's a hand tool exercise because you're actually running the chisels all by hand. So this top drawer is all sectioned off for all the screws that you would need, the most common sizes anyway. The bottom drawer, this is all my dovetailing tools. This is designed to come out and sit on the bench, and that's got everything that I need other than my dovetail saw and fret saw. Over here, this is where I store all of my sharpening gear. Now, I want to show you the difference in the drawers. Part of the idea of building this out of pine was to keep it light, and actually, that was the main reason, to keep it light. So the drawer sides are only 3/8 of an inch thick. And this is typical drawer construction. So by the time you've cut a groove in the drawer side to house the drawer bottom, you've reduced the strength of this drawer side right here to 3/16 of an inch. And if that was going to be taken out and set down in a lot of places, there's a good chance that would get bumped and end up cracking or breaking. So what I did on this heavier drawer designed to hold all the sharpening gear. First thing you'll notice, I made the drawer sides a lot thicker. But in this one, instead of putting the drawer bottom into a groove, I actually glued this drawer bottom directly to the bottom side of the drawer, which makes it extremely strong, but far more suited, or better suited, for coming out with a lot of heavy stuff and being set on a bench or wherever it happens to be set. Those are my three stones that I use, my diamond plate, my 6,000, my 16,000, my heavy holder, and the hone right product that I use for lubricating. That fourth drawer will be a place to keep the wedges for the bench hook, and not the bench hook, but the saw bench and whatever else, a few other items I need. Okay, now let's go off to the side. Over here, and the idea was to try to get as many tools in here as possible, because invariably you're going to want something you didn't bring, so I tried to think it through. First thing with my saws, the saws sit down into a sleeve or a holster. If you have to pull them straight out like this, then it makes all this area useless because it would be in the way. So what I did is I pivoted all these. There's a pin that runs through here and holds this in place, so they come out here and you can grab them. This is my dovetail saw, and this one actually is a piece of burnt maple, bird's eye maple, which is really gorgeous stock. The next one is my crosscut saw. This one is made out of a piece of Brazilian rosewood, which I salvaged from an old level I bought at a flea market. And this is my medium tenon, and this is out of a piece of purple heart, and that's the color that it gets once it's been exposed to light. Here I have my awl. This was actually a turn with a friend of mine, Larry, up in Ontario. And behind here is my Kerfex 10, and I recently released a YouTube video on this. This helps speed up the process of doing half blinds. It goes in and finishes a cut that you can't do with the saw. Then I have my two gauges. I have my mortise and gauge back here. I have my marking gauge here. This is one of the new ones I'm doing now out of, this is actually ebony. My mallet sits in here, my fret saw. This is my panel gauge. The panel gauge has the coping saw in behind it. Panel gauge is like a large marking gauge. So if I'm preparing a piece of lumber, I get a reference face first, a reference edge, and then to get the opposite edge parallel, can't very well use a marking gauge because by the time the cutter gets out beyond the head, even 4 or 5 inches, it starts to rack on you. Well, a panel gauge has a large surface here that would run along the reference edge and preventing the tool from twisting like that. And that sits up in there. Everything is designed to stay in place during transit. So the hammer is sitting on a dowel, and it's got a little bit of a slope to it, just enough to hopefully, working with gravity, keep that in place. Over on this side, I have my screwdrivers, and I had to figure out a way to, again, make everything compact. So they're on there's a hole in them, so I just inserted an aluminum rod, and I put the ones that are used most commonly out toward the front, but you're going to have to be patient if you need the one in the back. These are my bits to fit in my brace. I did put a little magnet in here just to keep this from swinging around. This is my drawer bottom plane. Now I have room in here for a twist drill or an egg beater style drill. I have one, but this only has a 1/4-inch chuck, and I've got to find one with a 3/8-inch chuck. These are my fish bits, which I think are the best drill bits you can find. I'll probably put more drill bits and maybe be in that bottom drawer, but these are fantastic. But that particular drill would only allow me to use 2 of these, so that's why I've got to find a bigger one. Now the center section. Start at the top. I have my level, and it sits into a little slot that once it goes in, it then drops down, and hopefully that'll hold it in place. On either side, I have my Lee Nelson panel saws. One's a crosscut, one's a rip. They're securely held in place. Just twist the toggle, pull the saw out. Kind of have to be careful, but there's a price to be paid for compactness. This is my flush trim. These are my chisels. These are my new IBC chisels. You can turn your own handles. That's why not all of them are stock. These are my mortise chisels. These are Lee Nelson's. There's my 18-inch straight edge. There's a couple of magnets and a little shelf to hold that in place. This is my scrub plane. This is made by Pinnacle. Now, this is the plane that you would start the processing with. It has a big, heavy blade, open throat. The blade has a convex grind on it, so you can go and remove a lot of stock quickly. And that sits down into that little recess so that, again, that stays put. Underneath is my small rotor plane. There's one magnet up in there, as well as a slot to hold it in place. This is a Lee Nielsen product. Accurate, and I think it's essential. Really good tool. Then I have my combination square. I've got my 12-inch here, 6-inch here. This is my skew block plane. And I consider this to be an essential joinery plane. This comes with a fence. This is a Lee Nielsen product, as I mentioned. And that hole is just the right diameter. It could have been a little bit bigger, but this definitely won't fall out. That goes in there. Tighten up the screw. And then you can adjust where your fence goes with this one. Now, you don't get the wood portion of it when you buy it. It's just you have the metal piece, and then you have to make the wood section yourself. But when the steel plate removed in the side, it allows you to wrap it, and it's extremely effective. Wouldn't want to be without that one. I do have a couple of magnets down there that'll help hold that in place. Now, down here in the bottom, again, I was limited in space. So I brought the tools that I think would cover the bases the best. The first one is my 5.5, and this is my do-everything plane. Great on the shooting board, has good mass, has sufficient length for the shooting board, but small and manageable for general purposes on the bench. Great, great plane. Then I have my block plane, and this is a adjustable mouth. Simply loosen the knob, and then you can open or close the throat to help control tear out. And this is a Wood River product. I have my small shoulder plane. Now this is a 1/2 inch. And in most cases, this tool is used to trim the end grain shoulder around a tenon in a mortise and tenon joint. So it's not very often you're going to have a shoulder that's wider than 1/2 inch. So certainly 95% of the time, this would do the job. Now, before I talk about these, I also bring my number 7. If you're going to be dimensioning long stock, you need the jointer in order to get that nice and flat. And in dimensioning, one of the ways of being able to evaluate your work and check your accuracy is with winding sticks. So winding sticks exaggerate any wind or twist in the board. The first thing you do once you get your board to sit flat is you want to make your reference face. And to check to see if it's flat, this particular winding stick sits at the back. Now there's a dot in the middle, so that when you set that on the board, you only have to judge the center of the board. You don't have to judge the center of the winding sticks and the center of the board. That one sits on the back, this one on the front, and as you sight down the two, comparing the top edges, the white stands out against the black inlay here, and you can determine whether or not there's any twist, and you can address it accordingly. You can get within a thousandth of an inch with these. Makes handwork extremely accurate. And they fit in there to separate the two planes so that they're not banging against each other when in transit. Everything has its place. This needs to be worked in maybe just a little bit more. That'll come with time. The case itself is fairly heavy. I think I used 7/8 inch pine. Yeah, I wanted it to be robust enough, but still keep it light, so everything is dovetailed, all three cases on all four corners each. All of these pieces, I'll just spin this around real quick and let you see. Just wanted to dress it up a little bit, but it also needed to be secure. So everything is held in place with brass screws with finish washers on them. There's one there I have to fix. Couldn't build it without at least one screw up. At the end of the day, if you're working in your garage, everything folds back in, put it away, and you're back in good graces with your wife. Now, I have two more things to do. One is to finish that fourth drawer. The other is what we're going to do with this. We originally had two pins in here that would fit in, and we would hang this by the hinges. But it made it awkward because throughout the day I'd be back and forth between teaching and needing to use the tools and trying to get at it. If I could come up with a way that would lift up and stay out of the way, it would be great. It may end up just sitting on here. I might have to put some kind of a little bit of a... Actually, probably the best thing to do would be to cut maybe a little bit of relief on there to set that in place. But got to have that whiteboard. Now, we filmed all of this. I think we filmed almost 200 episodes. On the hand tool workshop, we broadcast two episodes a week, 2 half-hour episodes. And as I mentioned, we try to limit duplication, so you would have only have seen me do maybe one or two corners. We don't videotape all four dovetail corners. Too much repetition. But a lot of this was experimental. We had to go in and come up with effective and interesting ways of holding the tools. Remember, it had to be held secure, but you also had to be able to access it relatively easily. Anyway, I was happy with the way it turned out. If you're interested, you can go to robsworkshop.com. It's in the hand tool section. You have to be a member to access it, but all of those previously shot videos are available to anybody that's a member. And there's probably 1,400 episodes that are sitting up there now, as of now. Anyway, let me know what you think. If any comments, you got any ideas for hanging the whiteboard, I'd love to hear them. And maybe we'll take a final shot. I put a finish on the bottom section. I haven't put any finish on the top. I still have that to do, but I wanted to shoot this and get it out to you. Hope you enjoyed it. See ya.